Hey, this is Chris from the Ticket Stub. You're listening to Lone Star Community Radio on 104.5 KCZW LP Conroe and 106.1 KZCC LP Conroe and worldwide on IRLoneStar.com.
We're the princes of the universe. Here we belong. Fighting for survival. We've got to be the rulers of you all.
Hey, good morning.
That's a struggle hey right there.
Hey. Welcome to Dick and Skippy in the Mornings. It is Wednesday already. It's hump day. Hey, Dick, guess what day it is? Dick, what day is it?
I want it over. That's what kind of day it is.
Yeah,
I want
right?
it over already.
It's
talking to me like that.
The day before Friday Eve, but it's 9:18 in the morning on a bright and cool December the 4th in historic downtown Conroe. Current weather right now is that it is 55 degrees. It's going to get up to the 70s, but back down to the 40s tonight. And it's going to be kind of temperate, as they say on the Weather Channel, for the next few days. Kind of partly cloudy. No rains or storms or anything till maybe next Tuesday. Yeah. And who knows what's, you know, no one can figure out what's going to happen by next Tuesday.
Now, the weather was nice last night, so if you missed the tree lighting, folks, you know, you lucked out.
So you were there on that, right? Now,
I was there. The only thing, the funniest thing about that whole night was no one really knew when the tree was supposed to go on. So I was told, you know, we had Elizabeth West here on Monday, who's in charge of all that stuff. And it was
Elizabeth. You're about to be thrown under the bus.
It was 6:30, from what I understood.
Okay,
right? Did you understand 6:30?
I understood as much as I listened to it. Yeah.
So we hurry over after getting some Conroe coffee, and Holly and I, and we sat there, and their PA system was not to the point where you could hear everything, and so we sat there for 25 minutes till about seven. It was about 7:05, and I was like, "Did I miss something? What are they talking about? Are they saying it's not working? Like, so we." I couldn't hear anything, and all of a sudden you hear 9, 8, and I'm like, oh, wait, after 35 minutes, we're freaking turning on the lights now.
They could have been trying to find the plug.
Yeah, it's my guess.
You know, maybe the extension cord, you know, they were right there.
Yeah, a lot of people, though.
4 inches short.
Way
to hit
too
the
many
plug.
People.
Oh, I remember being there a couple of years ago as part of the festivities, passing out programs and stuff like that, and it was quite the French Quarter set up there.
Well, I'm going to offer my services for next year because
you
couldn't hear anything, and then there wasn't any organization. It'd be like they pass it on to people, and people didn't know how to use the mic. They were, you know, they were talking like over here, so you hear them go like, "Today's festivities, you don't make sure."
Oh, so you feel that there wasn't a dress rehearsal?
And then you give the next person, they're really loud, and I'm like, all right, you just need to have one MC, and then if the mayor wants to talk. One thing I have a question though is the Reverend prayed, and I was like, are we allowed to be doing this right now?
Sure, why not?
At a city event?
Why not?
I was curious.
Yeah.
I always feel like there's a stigma with that kind of stuff.
Well, there's a stigma, of course, but I mean, it's like, Commissioner, I think it's Charlie Riley's, like, under constant lawsuit because he institutes prayers.
That's Wayne Mack, dude.
Wayne Mack. I'm sorry, it was Wayne Mack. Thank
but
you
But he does
much.
It before they open.
Right.
So it's not a problem. Like, it's voluntarily. Like, if you show up for court and, like, 20 minutes early, he opens the doors and he invites people in if they want to come and pray. Mm-hmm. It isn't like if you're going to court, you got to sit there and listen to this prayer. Like, you can voluntarily go into the court early.
Right.
Maybe it's like a sneak thing, though. It's like, if you want to get out early, you can come in early and pray. I can totally see churches doing that.
Well, I told you, as far as sneaking is concerned, in England, when they had morning assembly, because it's like total integration of church and state, I would just hang out with the Jewish guys in the other room because they were excused.
Yeah. So, when I went to Abilene Christian University, I hung out with the international students because it's so much easier because they had a lot have a lot more things
going
on.
Well, I was the international student back then. That was so cool. But yeah, here's the thing. Remember the First Amendment says there shall be no.
I was curious. I was just like, oh, this
no,
is random.
Basically, there would
I
be
could
an
hear
establishment
the prayer.
Of
conspiracy theory
of a
right there.
National religion. There would be no Church of America.
Okay.
That's what it said. So the separation means, yeah, you could do stuff. You just
fair enough. All right.
And again, people here.
I'm not trying to cause
could,
a problem. I was
they could
curious.
Have gone down the block if they didn't want to hear. That's what I'm saying. So.
Yeah.
But now, afterwards, wasn't there like a storefront contest?
Oh.
And we actually got a couple of tokens, didn't we?
Yeah, some poor saps.
So
felt sorry for us.
So businesses in downtown Conroe were encouraged to decorate their windows, and with people would be given a token, and they could throw in a slot as to their favorite. And how many tokens did we get, Dick?
Round 10. We got 10.
10 whole tokens?
Yeah.
Out of like what you think like 3,000-4,000 people showed up last night?
There's a lot of people. I don't know. Okay. We got a little too much.
Okay, so we got 0.2% of the vote. I'll take it.
You know, there was a lot of people when people were parking in the alleyway where it says no parking because they're risking being towed. That's how many people were here. They're like, I can't walk. We can't find a place. We got to get to this tree lighting. And then, of course, Holly didn't know how to back out her car, so I had to back out her car not to hit anything.
Now, weren't we told the other day that there would be plenty of parking in the garage?
Well, I mean, it was that full.
Wow.
So a garage can only be that big.
Next year, they may have to fix that.
I guess.
Dick, we need to introduce our guest because we've been talking for like 7 minutes now.
We're just doing an introduction. You know, we're doing the intro show.
The intro.
We do have a special guest here. We have a show, if you didn't know, perfect timing on Wednesdays following this show is the Homeowners Show. And it's for anything about homeowning. No renters allowed.
Anything about homeowning.
Oh, actually, no, we have renters allowed, right? Because you could rent to people. And you take care of the rental house, right?
I wonder what the extent...
We'll find... Hold on, I got to turn on your mic.
Yeah, you're nobodies right now.
So who's in the studio with us,
So Sean? we got Craig, we got Kevin in the studio. So these are a couple of... We had Craig on about a week or so ago, right?
Yeah, I was on... I think
Excalibur Pest Control.
Almost exactly a week ago.
Yeah.
So...
Back already. And he's, of course, with Excalibur Pest Control, and we were asking all kinds of questions on that. And
I'm still repping the gear. I got the logo rocking.
Yeah, there he goes. If you zoom in on him, you'll see he's wearing it.
And the truck.
And the truck, yeah. It's right there across
just
the street.
Just drive by the studio.
Do you have like a custom horn?
I need a custom horn.
Yeah.
They make those. Yeah. That are like
you could
like
do the charge.
Horns.
You could do the charge.
Horn.
The charge?
Like, charge. You know, I can see it because you got Excalibur.
I used to have one that played Dixie, but that became,
Yeah, the little General Lee thing, right?
Yeah.
No, I would do like the Emperor's theme from Star Wars, and that way you're warning the pests you're coming. You know, you're going to die.
If I could get that in a train horn, I'm all over
it. Oh, there we go.
Okay.
And Kevin, how did you...
Which we could also do that when the city is forcing people to pray.
There we go. On your knees.
That would get sprayed. That would be pretty baller last night if someone came up with a train horn like in the middle of the whole thing. Just blare it. And we're like, oh, okay.
It's a mighty amen.
Or do it when the tree actually goes on. Yeah. So everyone thinks there was something wrong. Yeah. That'd be good. So Kevin, how are you involved with this guy?
Well, I'm
it's also involuntary.
Yeah, well, I'm actually
he
the,
owes me money,
I'm the
man.
Brains behind the operation here.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
Wait, Craig's the looks? Oh, wow, you guys are hosed.
Yeah, it's a bad
That's
combination.
That's why we're on radio.
That's right.
They're testing the market. They're probably swap after 2020.
Yeah, right.
We've known each other for a few years now, and we just kind of got together talking about potentially doing this podcast and trying to find a niche. There's... How many hundreds of thousands of podcasts it seems like, and so trying to find one that would work for us, that we would enjoy doing, and something that 75 million other people aren't doing.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a lot of podcasts out there about specifically what we're trying to do. There may be like maybe one other,
really,
it's the Homeowners Show.
Yeah.
So kind of give me like the synopsis of it in the description when I search for it.
Yeah, so it's kind of a wide berth of topics on it because we bring in professionals a lot. That's what we really enjoy doing is like, I think last, not the one that came out, not the one that's going to be airing today, but last Wednesday, we interviewed an electrician, Weston Simon, and he's an awesome guy and he really knows his stuff. He's a master electrician. And so we brought him into the studio, him and his wife, to talk about their business, what they do for homeowners, and issues and things that, people that own homes or rent homes or that looking into buying homes, issues they need to be looking out for, or issues that can be corrected. What would you actually hire an electrician for? What sort of language do you need to know? What's the vernacular of hiring this professional? Because a lot of people are intimidated by people in those professions because they don't speak the language.
Mm-hmm.
And so like a plumber could come in and say, well, you need to do this, that, and the other, and they're labeling all these things. They don't know what those are because they're not a plumber.
Yeah, and then they put a price tag on it. And it's like, it's going to be $900 to fix your toilet. And you're like, I can go buy one for like $100. So why is it going to cost so much? And maybe you legitimately need to spend that much money. But just having some tools in your tool belt of why and having some smart questions to ask, that's kind of what we're hoping with these guests is to bring them on – and say, what do we need to know as a homeowner before you arrive at our house? And what do you actually do? And so at the end of the day, they're not, you know, leaving our house going, man, I just got hosed. You know?
Yeah, no one wants to feel like they've been taken advantage of, or like, and no one also wants to be in that space of like, I don't know what's going on with my house.
Right.
You know, and like, what is this person actually doing? What's the process? And so if you could have a conversation with somebody before you actually spend the money.
So you're telling people to rent? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, if they get everyone to rent, the podcast is suddenly over.
That'd be fine with me, because then I'll just go buy the houses and rent them out.
Let me ask you this then, because this is a weekly show, weekly podcast available on Tuesday. So actually, the show you're going to hear on Lone Star after this is available right now to listen to on demand.
Yeah.
When you're talking about owning a home, don't you think that would bring anxiety on folks because of the woes of owning a house?
Absolutely.
So what do you see as the advantage of owning a home?
Well,
you can do whatever you want, basically.
Yeah, it's your property at that point. And you're like, you know, if you're, and we even talk about that. I mean, like, we brought in someone to talk about homeowners associations. You know, like, what can you do to your property legally? And
well, you infiltrate the HOA.
That's right. Take it over.
Change it. It's not hard.
Or you buy around an HOA.
That's right.
And just, you're close enough to the HOA, but not so close that they actually can tell you what to do.
Yeah. Or you buy unrestricted property. I mean, and that's really what we're trying to alleviate, is that anxiety. Not alleviate it, but like just sort of explain it. And like, how do you actually deal with it? How do you come to terms with it?
There's so many things about owning a home that you probably just don't think about. Like, one of the things that we were talking about just recently is that it's important to prepare your home for winter. I mean, we don't get hard winters down here, but some of the people that listen to our podcast aren't here in Houston. And so, but even still, I mean, there are moments whenever it gets cold. So you probably need to winterize your irrigation system. So if you've got a sprinkler system, you probably need to winterize it. I don't know how to do that, but somebody does. And so, but maybe I don't know that I need to do that unless somebody tells me, because I don't want to, you know, get caught one day with my, you know, my backflow preventer is busted and all of a sudden water.
That's the big one around here. Yeah. Is the backflow. Yeah.
And water's flowing, you know, out, and I don't even know where the shutoff is. And so we're trying to just kind of
that kind pre-empt. Of stuff surprises me when I learn people don't really know about their home.
Yeah,
because when I was growing up, my dad had four boys to do everything he wanted. So whenever
that's why you had four boys.
Yeah, like so whenever it came to fixing something, cleaning something, or you know maintaining something, we were there, and we had to follow. If we needed a plumber, we had to follow the plumber. Mm-hmm. If we had a painter, we had to follow the painter. So he basically goes into the room with the painter. He's like, "Hey, you got four people here to help you. You know, like whatever you want them to do, just tell them what to do." And then learning through that, and then being like visiting friends who have houses, like they don't even know how to shut off their water.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, you might want to take a picture of that and put it on your fridge. So if your wife's alone here and something happens, like,
yeah. Right.
Like that's really going to happen. And it probably will happen when you're not here. And
it most certainly will happen when you're not there. I mean, like, statistically, that's when it happens.
Yeah, so
when you're not at home.
Yeah, well, and you know, I think that's part of the thing that, you know, you asked a great question. Why would you want to own a home? I mean, at the end of the day, if you don't own your home, you're spending a lot of money to live somewhere, and it's not doing anything for you. And now we've said on the show multiple times, a home's a liability. It's not an asset, but it is an investment. It is something that you're at least pouring something into, rather than, you know, if you're renting or if you're living in an apartment or whatever, that money's going nowhere. I mean, you're paying someone else to live there. Now, you don't have to really worry about a lot of things, but I think that you at least feel like you're doing something with your money. But then you have to know how to do something if something happens. Like, you have to know how to fix things if something goes awry. And so a lot of what we're doing on this podcast is helping people have some information of, okay, if something happens, who do I call? I don't know who to call. And so we've interviewed a plumber. You at least know that the plumber that we've interviewed is worth calling. And we've given you some information on how to get a hold of him. And you know that you know he's going to do a good job whenever he shows up.
And if you're not like in Montgomery County, like, you know what a good plumber sounds like.
That's right.
Well, it sounds like you're separating the wheat from the chaff, because much like a mechanic, you know, take your car in, their job is to make sure your car runs, but also their job is to make sure that they can afford next month's rent. So there's always that gray area of that, you know, they're not necessarily padding something or cooking the books, but they may be suggesting things that may help you in the long run that you may not need right then. It's sure. the same thing with plumbing. You know, you could have, fix your drip. We could tear out all the plumbing and replace everything, or we could spend $399 on this L joint or something.
Right.
Yeah. I hope to God that L joint is an actual plumbing term, because I just said that. Is it?
It could be.
Okay.
It
could be. There we go.
Yeah. If not, you may have just coined it.
Trademark pending.
Which is usually my job on the show, to make up words.
That's true.
Well, with the technology being implemented in homes and things,
yeah.
Do you see that technology helping maintaining the house?
Yeah, that's a huge area that we cover as well, because we do a lot of product reviews as well. When we don't have a guest, we're usually doing some sort of technology into the home. I think the most recent that we did was the Casetta smart light system.
That's right.
Which I just put in my house, which is fantastic, because I can pick up my phone. I can literally turn on and off the lights at whatever dimming I want from here. They're connected via Wi-Fi. They're voice controlled.
Is there a physical switch?
There is a physical switch and remote control and an app on my phone and Alexa. Is there an Alexa
here?
I don't want to set anything up.
Well, no, that's always like, because when my grandfather, that was his thing, that he hated technology when it came to his house.
Sure.
And like, he hated the gate opener because it would change, you know, and he had problems. Like mm-hmm. That was the thing he hated. And I always thought, you know, when you're making all these really cool tech stuff, like a Nest
and
stuff. And then, like, for example, I was looking for remote locks for the studio, but they don't make it combine it with old school and new school, where, like, you couldn't lock it manually. You had to use the app to lock it or even take it off. I'm like, well, I don't want to see her.
Actually, I want to ask you about, like, because I know smart homes are, like, the thing. And, for instance, the most techie I got at my house is I have a touch plate for my, you know, you punch in a code to come in my front door, but it also has a key.
Yeah.
You know, because, again, old school, I'll bring out cars again. They're saying, now if there's ever, like, EMP going out, your car is going to die. Or if you drive into water, you're going to drown unless you have this little thing that punches the window. Just buy a car from the 70s, because back then it would survive EMP, because there's no electronic ignition.
That's right.
You drove into water, you roll down the window.
That's right.
And so, you know, not all, there's no manual backup on that. You know, if you drive into heavy water.
On some of them, yeah.
But what I'm saying is, like, you know, the rolling up of, or rolling down of a window in a car, if it's power windows, you're in water, you're hosed unless you break it. And so many people don't have that tool. So same thing with a smart house. I imagine the convenience must be astoundingly wonderful.
Oh, yeah.
But are there manual overrides? Or
I think it depends on that's why you have to research the product you're purchasing.
Are they also hack-proof?
So...
Because if I got that stuff, I know you'd be hacking in Jack with my thermostat.
I mean, that's the paranoia thing. Like,
just
I'm
because
not,
you're paranoid doesn't mean they're not out to get you.
Well, true. I mean, like, because it's always funny to me where larger companies are trying to do things that they say make it easier, but then it's so invasive.
Yes.
You're like, should you really be worried about, you know, buying the smart home because people can listen to you and do all those kind of things? And then it's kind of like a trade-off, because you're really not worried about people listening. You'd rather be able to say, "Hey, turn on the lights in the foyer or whatever," and then it's like, "Oh, cool, it works." But then like another one, like I like Amazon's always trying to figure it out. And like, remember they were talking about doing the smart locks, where their delivery drivers could come up and they have this like a
going on,
yeah, and like they have access to your house and then they could put it inside and leave and all that kind of stuff. And like I think everyone has their own opinion on it and see what works, and especially what areas of the country you live in.
Yeah, because you don't have to have those things. I mean, like, you can absolutely have a manual lock. You can absolutely have manual switches. I mean, like, and have a perfectly efficient home.
And I think part of that depends on how you're interacting with your home. I mean, and I know that's a weird way to put it, but, you know, for us, for Craig and I specifically, I mean, we've got young families, and both... You know, he and his spouse both work. Me and my spouse both work. And so, you know, a lot of times we're out of the house and there are things that need to continue to happen at our house even when we're not there. You know, for example, we've got, both of us, we have smart thermostats in our house. Well, I don't have to think about, oh, man, I left the air conditioner on all day.
Well, especially with today's weather here in Houston, it's like,
well, I've got 2 days a programmable ago, one where, you know, at 8 sure. o'clock it goes up to, you know, high during the summer because I'm not there or something.
Sure, but even that is, I mean, what if the battery goes out on that?
True.
I mean, so you're still not foolproof on that. Mm-hmm. I mean,
then you got to reprogram it.
Then you got to, yeah, exactly. Indeed. Unless it's hardwired, and you know, so they used to have just the straight up manual ones, and those still work. But
we
if
just
you,
kill the AC when you leave.
That's right. And so, but if you don't, like if you forget, or you know,
good. Or conversely, I don't want it 92 degrees inside my house, so when I come home,
sure, right, that exactly.
You can kick it in half an hour early.
Yeah, I tell you, one of the life-changing things for me on that was geofencing my thermostat. That was just life-changing.
Because you got to explain that word. So is that one of your made-up words, Greg?
No.
this one actually exists.
This one's real.
Because I think you can geofence your sprinkler system, too.
Yeah, you can geofence a lot of things now with the
which is pretty damn cool.
What is it, IFTTT? Or?
Yeah.
Okay. So, which is a cool app. It's free.
IFTTT stands for if this, then that.
Yeah.
It's basically
a logic app.
If this happens, then do something else. So for example, the geofencing is if I go into this certain radius of my house, then I want you to unlock my door.
How's
I
your
want
battery you life?
On my phone?
Jeez.
It's plugged in all day because
yeah,
it's in my
that's
truck.
What, yeah, because you're geofencing everything. Because I know like the sprinkler system stuff's cool because it might not be the geofencing, but basically if it rains somewhere, if it's raining in your house, it'll know that.
Yeah.
And so it won't start the sprinkler system for X amount of days.
Yeah, Kevin actually has that. He has the same one on his house that they have over at the Ag Extension Center that they use over there.
And it's awesome.
And it's exactly what you're talking about.
I'll tell you this. We live in a mud district, so our water.
What does that mean?
It's a municipal utility district.
So does that mean somebody takes care of that? What
do you
mean?
It means basically
my money takes care of it.
Yeah, they
of the draining things.
Supposedly you have more control over some things, but some people would say you have less. It just kind of, I mean, it's
just one of those HOA things, like whoever's in charge of it. That's how
the HOA determines which mud you use on some level. So it
gets tricky around here. Water stuff in Conroe is weird.
Yeah, it is. But our water and our sewer and trash are all on the same bill. And this summer, the highest bill I had was $68 for my water. And that's because my smart water system, I mean, it rained a lot during June and July. And so a lot of people are out there watering their lawns. I mean, I'm walking my dog at 6 o'clock in the morning and everybody's water is going. I'm like, it rained 4 inches yesterday. Why are you watering your lawn?
Because they're on a timer.
Because it's on a timer and it's a manual timer because those are the cheapest and that's what most people put on. And so, you know, they're watering 5 days a week, and I didn't water all of June, I don't think, you know, because I didn't have to.
Well, a lot of these cool things they can hear about on your show, but is there always that line where it's just going to cost a lot of money, or is it, do I kind of buy something I can put on top of it? Like the sprinkler system, is that something I have to redo my irrigation system at my house?
No, I mean, I literally just took off the old controller and plugged in the new controller. And you know, there's
that was like $500 or something like that.
No, it was like $150. It was $150. And you know, people are telling me they spent $120 on water last month, and I spent $68. And I'm going, okay, I can do math that easy. So in like 3 months, I can pay for this thing. So I mean, some of it you look at and go, okay, that's just an added expense. I mean, smart lights. I mean, I can walk in and turn my lights on.
The clapper.
Yeah, the clap of the old. Yeah. Yeah. Clap on, clap
Sean
off.
Has that. Sean looks like a clapper.
Yeah.
And?
It's better than a flapper, I guess.
Yeah, there you go.
So, but, you know, I think that, again, it depends on how you want to interact with your house. I mean, if you are concerned about people, you know, hacking in and all those sorts of things, you don't even need to have Wi-Fi at your house, you know, or you need to put a pretty sophisticated firewall up. And you know, we actually, one of our very first episodes,
just live underground.
Yeah, I mean, we did a episode.
It is nice and cool down there.
No
manhole cover would be like your front door, so no one really knows.
Yeah, It's just a slide. You just jump down the hole, and it's a slide into your living room.
Because no one's going to spend the time trying to lift like a 40-pound deal. They're like, I'm not dealing with that right now.
Yeah, we did an episode early on with a guy who basically talked through the dangers of having smart devices in your house because, you know, it's like there's a meme out there. I don't know if you've seen it. And the first picture is from like the 50s, and this lady's calling someone else, and she says, hey, why don't you come over? I'm afraid the government is tapping my phone. Mm-hmm. And the next picture says, hey, wiretap, order me a pizza. You know, it's like, you know, Alexa is, you know, controlling the world and its own. So it is, it kind of is what it is. You know, you have to.
You just turned on my Alexa.
Oh, sorry about that.
So and to the listeners.
QED, there you go.
Yeah, so, right. I mean, again, it depends on how you want to interact with your house. If you want, if you're going to be in your house all the time, maybe it's not worth having all.
What about like bidets? What are your feelings about bidets?
We have not reviewed a bidet.
I feel like that's a European thing and it's coming over here.
You'd be surprised how many houses have them put in now.
Yeah.
I mean, it is kind of like
those big water fountains. Yes. Yeah, I know.
Yeah. Well, like, boy, I was thinking
for short people.
There's even your show could even apply to some renters too, because there are some things that you can do, you know, to take care of like that thing you're renting. Because I know everyone's big fears when they move out, they're gonna have to pay, they lose their deposit, and like, how do you fix, you know, some of these things? Like, let me ask y'all this, if y'all know this. I always wondered, is there an app or some device that you could take a paint and see what paint it is?
Several.
So is it really easy to figure that out? Have they mastered that craft yet?
The issue will be what brand of paint you end up using, because different brands have their own apps.
Yeah.
But
if you go to Home Depot, isn't it where you can take a shaving or scraping? Just take it to Home Depot. They'll scan it and...
Yeah,
get it down for
you can, but there's also just generic apps that aren't paint brand specific, because those, you know, obviously those paint brands are trying to push you on their brand.
Yeah.
So they're going to push their colors.
I just want to paint it the same color.
Right.
So I'm just trying to figure that
there
out.
There are, you know, the issue you'll
toothpaste
run into
in the hole instead of spackle. Yeah.
Is
I've done it
with the lighting. So you can absolutely match the color, but depending on what kind of light you have on the wall, you're probably going to get five different colors off that wall or swatch or whatever it ends up being. Just because, you know, light changes the shade.
Mm-hmm.
And so there are apps that do that. You just got to be careful, you know, which one you end up, what the number you end up giving the paint mixer at the store. Because you can end up with something really, really different.
So so there's apps for it, and then you see you can take shavings, like CSI stuff?
Well, like you could, for instance, I mean, let's say it's in the kitchen. You could take a cabinet door off and take it to Home Depot, or...
I wonder what the strangest thing someone's brought in.
An elephant, it's probably.
Right now I'm in a scenario, and I'm trying to figure out, my grandmother's moving out.
Right.
And she has, like, a 1952 Chambers oven.
Uh-huh.
And it's in, like, top condition. I really want it.
Yeah.
And it's gas, and I'm like, all right, how do I manage this? Because I rent right now, so there's no way, you know, I could ever put that in a renter's house. It weighs, like, you know, a ton. And so I'm thinking, out of Sun Holidays, like, do you have to build a house around that? Or is that something that, like, that's a custom install, right? And that's just going to cost a lot of money.
It depends on the size of it. Yeah.
Put the oven on the foundation and then just start building the walls around
it. Well, I mean, I can see that being the stump. I can. It's heavy, man. It's a heavy duty.
Is it, you said it's gas? Is it also wood fire?
No.
No? Okay.
It's just gas.
Okay. Well, I don't know why you'd have to like custom build it. It's probably got a standard size. I mean, like, I think those things are usually like 32 or 37 inches.
As long as you can get it through the door.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably one of the biggest deals when you're building a house or when you buy a house and you want to put certain things in.
Well, yeah, and you also have to think, like, does the house that I'm moving into, does it have the appliances that I want? So, for example, the house I'm in, there is gas in the house. A lot of the houses don't have gas. It's all electric, but our cooktop specifically is electric. I would rather it be gas, and so I actually had a plumber come over and say, hey, what would it take to get gas to the cooktop? And so he said, well, yeah, you can do it. It's cost you about $500. So it depends on what you want to pay, but as long as you can get that thing through the door and there's gas already at the house, you're golden.
Cool.
Well, even if there's not gas at the house, sometimes the gas company's willing to run the lines for you. Like, I know at my folks' house, they didn't have gas when they moved in you know, however many decades ago. But they decided to put in a gas generator. And the gas company basically told them, like, look, put in three gas appliances and we'll run the lines for you. So if you're in a, place where there's gas accessible, usually the gas company, you know, because they want you to start paying the money, they're happy to put the lines in for you. Kevin's in a different situation because his house already has gas, and so he's just going to have to run an additional line to his cooktop if he wants to do that.
I want to go back to the wood-burning stove because I love that idea.
Oh, man, I'm in love with those.
Are they like a thing now?
I guess it kind of depends on what kind of person you are. If you're kind of like a prepper or a backwoods kind of guy,
right. I'm not that paranoid.
But
in the HOA, they allow that kind of stuff. Uh-huh.
Yeah, but I mean, like, they're fantastic. I mean, I if you have like a if you have a cabin or something like that, they're really efficient. There's different kinds of wood burning stoves too. Like there's some now. I met a lady not too long ago. She was an MIT grad. It was an elderly woman, but she was an inventor, and she had invented what she called a dragon stove, and it was a multi chamber, so you could put in like, you know, five or six sticks into the top of this stove, light them on fire, and the smoke would end up going through these multiple chambers. So instead of smoke coming out the stack the other end, it would actually heat the smoke up enough to where the smoke would basically combust inside the stove and radiate heat through the room. So you could light it inside a house without getting any smoke in the house and heat the house efficiently. It was crazy. And she showed it to me. It was like, I didn't even know something like that was even possible.
Cool. Dick, your trivia question, who invented the modern stove? The stove that would actually distribute the heat. Well, a particular human being.
Oh, I don't know then. Sorry.
It was the 1700s when he did it.
No idea.
He narrowed it down for you by 50% by telling you it was a man.
Yeah, Ben Franklin.
Oh, was it really?
Mm-hmm, the Franklin stove.
Stove.
I had no idea.
Yep.
Wow.
Well, you know, speaking of, you know, brand name stoves, with Amazon and all these kind of companies, because, but, you know, 50 years ago, Sears was the place for your home appliances.
Ugh, and then, like, depends
on where you live.
Are they not making stuff anymore?
Well, that's one thing I was always wondering is, are reputations still a thing when purchasing things for your home?
Oh, yeah. But yes, they are. But what is interesting is the reputations are they seem to be more viable with older people. Like, younger people are like, I went online and I looked at the reviews, and the reviews say this one's a whole lot better than that one. And so some of these companies, you know, you mentioned cars earlier. I mean, let's look at Cadillac. Cadillac used to be the luxury car here in America, and now people are like, Cadillac? Who drives a Cadillac? You know, like, that's...
They drive a Cybertruck.
Yeah, is that a thing anymore?
I'm getting one.
And so I think it's one of those things where it's kind of like older people still look at Cadillacs and like, I've always wanted a Cadillac. Like, I want to buy a Cadillac. And so it's like, you know, you look at
I naturally trust Amana or Kenmore or GE over anyone else because I've grown up with them the last 50-some-odd years.
That's right. And sometimes, you know, I want a Maytag, you know, whatever. And I think some people look at that, and it's really hugely important, but then you've got new companies like Samsung is making washer and dryers, and LG is making washer and dryers. I thought those were like TV companies, and so you get into these, are brands important? And at the end of the day, you know, one thing I would tell people is just, why don't you go actually do the research? It's very easy to do the research and figure out what people are saying actually works and doesn't.
Yeah, I think the big shift that we're seeing right now is I think you're right in that we're moving away from brand recognition so much as we are feature recognition. You know, people are more interested in the features than they are necessarily what the name is. And so, like, you'll find people buying weird off-brand names just because it has a feature that appeals to them more than it does, like, the name that goes along with it. Because you look at, I think Samsung is the one that came out with, like, the video screen refrigerator. And like that blew up for a while because people were like, "Oh my gosh, this is such a cool feature." Even though, like, you know,
what's it really doing?
Yeah. and so, like, you know, people were doing their calendars and putting their family photos on that refrigerator. So it's a neat feature. Nobody else is doing it. And so, regardless of whether or not KitchenAid makes an actual physical better refrigerator, that feature was pushing people that direction.
Yeah.
And also just like what's important to you, because what I think is really weird is something that you're going to use every day. Like, let's just stick with the refrigerator as an example. Something that you're going to use every day, like the refrigerator, to keep your food cold, to keep it from spoiling, all these kinds of things, that they'll want to look for a bargain on that. Like, I only want to spend like $200 on my refrigerator, but we'll spend $600 on a record player because they want to listen to cool vinyl. You know, like that doesn't make sense to me because I like vinyl. I have a pretty cool vinyl collection, but I'm not spending $600 on a record player. The $50 one works great.
Yeah.
You know, but for somebody else, that quality matters to them in that product. Mm-hmm. And so they're going to shop for that rather than spend the money on the refrigerator.
Yeah, I mean, I had someone ask a question just the other day. They were asking about power tools. What's the best power tool out there? And someone said, well,
that's
you
can how fights start.
Yeah. It's like, you know, someone came up and they said, well, definitely like a Milwaukee. And I'm telling them, yeah, absolutely. Milwaukee's fantastic. And you're going to pay out the nose for it. How are you using that thing? Like, are you using that commercially? Like, are you a professional that is using that power tool for 8 hours a day for 3 or 4 years and you need all the support that Milwaukee's going to get you? Or are you a weekend, professional who's working
on...
You can
just grab the Ryobi.
Absolutely. And then that's exactly what I told him. I said, listen, I've got all the Ryobi One stuff and it's fantastic. It works absolutely great. And it costs literally half or less than what that Milwaukee costs. So yeah, it depends, like Craig is saying, like, how are you using that thing and what is most important to you? If you feel like, oh, I've got to have the best, then go buy the best. If you feel like you want stuff that's really, really good, that's going to work for a long time, but you don't use it professionally, well, I mean, again, it's feature-driven.
Well, what's strange to me is you grow up during a time where, like, lifetime warranties are a thing. Mm. And I really don't know if that's really the case today.
Because mm-hmm.
I know pretty much when you go to a Best Buy or a Sears or wherever, they offer warranties that they'll replace it one stop. Like, right. At one time, they'll replace the whole unit, but you have 4 years.
Right. And pay additional for that.
You pay additional for it. And, like, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But I think that's the whole gamble with warranties. Like, that's part of it. And especially with technology being so advanced, it's almost like you need to get it because there's so many other factors that could go wrong that prevent the machine from actually working.
Right.
Especially the digital side, where, like, my favorite thing is, you know, how advanced these boards are on a machine that works with water. And you're like, okay. So all it takes is one robot to misslip the silicone or something, and then everything's gotten wet. And with the Craftsman thing, that's probably like a great example of the transition of a brand going to something where it's like, is it the same? Is it not? And you also have those people those weekend warriors who are now in their 70s who pass on their tools. I know I've gotten a lot of tools from my grandfather and a lot of tools from my dad. Mm-hmm. And I look at that, I'm like, I wonder if it wasn't necessarily the brand, but it was more of the person who took care of the tool and, yeah, you know, didn't just throw it on the ground when they're working and then stuff like that. So, I mean, is that something too? Would you encourage anybody who's going to spend money on any type of homeowner thing is take care of it? It's not just, a lot of people just kind of buy it and forget it.
Yeah.
Because there's not any maintenance with like a washer and dryer, is there?
Oh, so, yeah, there is. Yeah.
I don't know. I
yeah,
mean,
there's particularly
what do you
like
do
on
a washer
your,
and dryer episode. Apparently,
apparently we do. Yeah, like I know on ours, there's on your washer specifically, there's a filter that you're supposed to clean out at least once a month, and if you don't, it'll start your clothes will start getting stinky, you know, over
time.
So
where's the why don't they make that something that's so obvious? Because I can see where I know
they
where
want you to buy a new one.
Is that what it is? Because yeah, like the lint filter is right there, but I think that's a fire hazard. That's why they make it so obvious to clean the lint filter.
Well, and like the filter on the washing machine, it's one of those deals. Like unless you go looking for it, once you find it, it's like, oh, that's so obvious. Because it's usually right in front. And like I know ours is on the bottom left hand corner because I think we have Samsung washer and dryer, like the front loader, yeah, all that kind of stuff. When we finally realized, like, I think it was like 2 years after we had the thing that you're supposed to actually clean this thing out, it was nasty.
Well, because I can't imagine when you install these things, they pack them in. So it's like, oh, if it's on the left side, if it's on the outside, there's no way you're going to be able to reach that ever. Like,
right. It's just, right. It's, yeah, so
you're,
no. This,
you're stuck with it.
I'd have to look at, I mean, like, it depends on.
Are you looking it up right now?
No. We're live on Facebook here, so I was.
Oh.
So I was seeing if I could.
Yeah, let me hold it for you so you can get a better angle on you.
You want to get a better angle? Yeah. There you go.
We're gonna do the power angle.
Right. Well, you know, shoot down. Speaking of which, we're gonna do our top of the hour break. How about that, guys? Top of the hour break's coming right now. You're listening to Dick and Skippy in the mornings. We're on Facebook.com/Dick and Skippy, Conroe's FM 104.5, 106.1, and of course, IRLoneStar.com. We're going to take our sponsored break. We'll be right back.
Business office cleaning is available in the Montgomery County area from Clean Sweep Office Cleaning, with scheduled cleaning services such as floor care, window care, trash collection, restroom disinfection, and stair and elevator cleaning. Clean Sweep can service a business one time or on a regular schedule, with daily, weekly, and monthly options. Clean Sweep Office Cleaning can be found online at cleansweepofficecleaning.com or by calling 832-689-7996. Clean Sweep Office Cleaning. Take back your time and let us make your office shine. Mornings with Lone Star is sponsored by Clean Sweep Office Cleaning.
Are you one of those who feel that life is too short to drink bad coffee? Then come to Bean Pond Coffee. Bean Pond Coffee is open with two locations. Whether you're in downtown Conroe or historic Montgomery, we have the best fresh brewed and specialty coffee, delicious pastries, and courteous staff. Come visit us at 330 North Main Street in Conroe or 401 College Street, Suite 170 in Montgomery. Visit beanpunkcoffee.com to see our complete list of special events.
A Lone Star Community Radio is ready for the summer. If you or anyone you know is looking for summer internship opportunities, A Lone Star Community Radio is a great place to grab the mic and be on the air. A Lone Star Community Radio offers a great opportunity to those interested in learning about the radio world all year round. Be an on-air personality, talk show producer, or YouTube TV podcast editor. Contact the station at info@irlonestar.com or call the station's message line at 936-647-3776.
Statistics show that one out of every six Texans struggles with food insecurity and hunger. And many people don't eat enough fruits and vegetables every day. The Better Living for Texans program is here to help you learn how to make healthy menu choices, save money at the grocery store, prepare quick and delicious meals, get more good nutrition in your day, and get more physical activity. Classes are fun, friendly, interactive, and free, and taught in English and Spanish. We are Texas A&M AgriLife Extension, helping Texans make their lives better.
Hey guys, this is Connor.
This is Dick.
This is Chris.
And we're with the Ticket Stub Podcast every Thursday live at noon on 104.5 and 106.1 FM in the Conroe area. Also, anytime at IRLoneStar.com. You go to IRLoneStar.com/TTS. You can find all of our social media.
And don't forget, we give away two tickets to the Grand Theater on every show.
If you like movies and you like complaining or celebrating, anything has to do with the silver screen, check out the Ticket Stub Podcast and join us every Thursday at noon o'clock on Lone Star Community Radio.
Health Center Southeast Texas is a federally qualified health center. We accept Medicare, Medicaid, and most major private insurances. For our self-pay patients, we have a sliding scale discount program available. Our health centers have qualified providers and staff striving every day to provide the best quality of care to our patients. Services offered are family medicine, behavioral health services, telepsychiatry, and pediatrics. We have four area locations. Look up the Health Center Southeast Texas online at hcset.com.
From the beginning, the main purpose of the Cooperative Extension Service has been to change human behavior by teaching people how to apply the results of scientific research. By utilizing a holistic, multi-level approach, Extension Family and Community Health Programs encourage health and well-being for everyone. Addressing values, concerns, and needs with reliable science-based information, Extension programs help people lead healthier lives. We are Texas A&M AgriLife Extension, helping Texans make their lives better.
Hey, it's 10:01 on the dot here on a Wednesday morning in sunny downtown Conroe. It's 61 degrees, going to get up to 72, 0%, well, 1% chance of rain, because we can't commit 100% to anything. And it's only 46% humidity outside, so it feels like it is. And the official Lone Star weather tree outside my window says...
I want to make sure Craig knows that he's on camera.
I know.
He knows.
Yeah, okay. He's making sure.
I don't care.
This is how he always looks.
That's right.
There's no bad publicity.
What's your comment there, Dick? Thought, this is my everyday face.
I thought you were doing your Instagram pose, like doing the duck face.
I haven't. Yeah. No, somebody's actually talking to me on here, so.
Feeling tool well, timey.
Do you want to talk
pose,
to us?
IDK.
No. these people are IDK. Way more important.
Have them call in. What's our line? They can call or text in.
This is actually a former guest, Jason Hernandez, who does pools.
Oh, yeah. That guy's cool.
Tell me the company name
it's
again.
It's not worth it. Don't worry about the company
endless
name.
Endless Summer Pools.
Okay.
It's not worth it.
What was that?
Pools aren't worth it.
Pools aren't worth it?
You guess the only way they're worth it is if you start charging neighbors. Like yeah, you gotta entry fee. You gotta help pay for some of the costs. Yeah. You
need to come see my pool because I think I've got it figured out.
Is it like a ground pool?
No.
From the water? Yeah. No.
No. It's mine's weird, man. You've probably never seen one like
that. Well, your house is weird.
My house is weird.
Yeah. That's so, a whole thing.
So are you trying to tell me the host of the Homeowners Show has like some weird stuff going on in his house? That's like how's your wife feel about that? I want to try to test this stuff out. Are you okay with that?
I want to know what kind of house he has.
She's good with it now.
That's only because you just did a massive remodel on your house.
If folks don't know, Craig went to school with my brother. And one of my favorite things, my brother's a big tech person, so when he tries to explain anything, and he's like, I remember when we were growing up, and the way he changed the computers and did all this stuff, he's trying to explain to my mom how to log in, she's like, I just want to just check something. It's like, well, you got to do this, and you got to make sure you're doing it this way. This is the link. I put it on the desktop,
yeah.
And this is how you're going to do that. And she's like, I just want to check things. And then, yeah. Craig. He's just putting stuff in the house. And
yeah.
It's like, how do I turn on the oven?
What is this Sabbath setting?
Okay, so I know it's kind of dark, but I have a friend, a married couple, that they actually bought a dome house.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
And, you know, a little bit of bag. I'm trying to see if I can find a better
picture. Well, Craig actually lives in a cave that he carved at a rock.
Yes.
And
well, yeah, I want to live in Bag End.
Is that,
you know?
Is that like a yurt? Is that what that is?
Yurts are typically like tents, aren't they?
That's what I thought.
No, this is an actual like house.
Is it like an earth house? Like that?
I think so, but everything inside is round. I'm just trying to see if I can find like better daytime shots of it.
Is this like an actual friend of yours or like someone you stalk on?
Oh,
on,
no. Okay. Minna and Dudley. Hey, guys, I doubt you're listening now, but just in case.
I mean, don't give their address away, but where is this place?
It's in the suburbs, I think, of West Houston.
Oh. Okay.
Like because one of our favorite karaoke bars is right there on like Derry, Ashford, and Richmond. And she doesn't live too far from there.
Okay.
So
tell them we'd like to come take a tour.
Does she have grass on her house? That was a thing in Houston for a bit.
Yeah. The grass roof?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know. I'm not the Homeowner Show.
You're actually seeing that more in like commercial buildings now than your
novel.
Houses.
It's novel.
Yeah.
Well, I just know my cousin's grandmother had it, and I thought it was the most bizarre thing because I was like, how do you mow this? And
just put AstroTurf up, I guess.
Or you get you a goat ramp.
I don't know.
Is someone on a roof? No, that's a goat.
It's a goat.
Maybe it has something to do with water absorption, I guess.
They're actually pretty efficient. And so
insulation kind of thing?
If you had
it keeps the house cool.
Yeah, yeah, you had a layer of sod, that would do it, wouldn't it?
It's almost like a hobbit hole.
Okay.
You know? So
I get it.
Where do you see the future of a homeowning going? Do you see it being more of... Because, I mean, there's... You could still be in an apartment and still being like a homeowner because I know people buy $1 million condos on Lake Conroe now.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
And when it comes to that kind of stuff, where do you see the future of homeowning going? Because it sounds to me you guys are more proactive. So you guys are that's what y'all like to do.
Yeah.
And you're sitting there like, oh, I need a smokehouse. I'm going to build that, and I'm going to learn how to do that. I'm going to, but some people are like...
That is on the list.
Some people are like, you know what? I budgeted $2,000 a month. So I'm going to take care of all my stuff. My pool, my, whatever.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that would be a pretty weird house to pay $2,000.
For me, the next thing is probably going to be like a barrel sauna. I mean, those things are awesome.
Well, for example, I used to mow lawns growing up, and I realized at one point the market got to the flux where it's just easier. Like, you don't need to mow it yourself. It's cheap. It's just it almost costs the same to pay somebody to mow your yard.
Right.
For gas and maintenance on your, once a year maintenance on your mower and all the gadgets and stuff.
Yeah.
Would you say, I mean, like, it's really weird.
And we actually ended up doing something like that on our website. We created a DIY calculator.
Yep.
And so it takes into account, because you're absolutely right. Like it's the cost of like your lawn, for instance, it's almost the exact same thing over time. You'll pay the same for someone else to do
mowers
it. Tear
are
their equipment
expensive.
Up, especially if you get a nice one, you know. And like I have a zero turn. I love the thing. But I like mowing my lawn.
Yeah.
And so we built this calculator for people to come in and say, okay, like if I'm going to like retile my bathroom, you can plug in all those numbers and figure out whether or not you actually need to be doing that, right? Because if you really enjoy it, it's mathematically going to factor that in, the end number of what it's going to cost to do that project. Because like you know, your mental well-being is important. And so if you're having to do a project that you don't enjoy, it might actually be worth it to pay a little bit more money to have a professional come in and them have the headache of dealing with, you know, which is what happened with my house. I was like, I got overwhelmed with the amount of projects in my house. And so we brought in a team to knock it out. But we were doing like a complete overhaul,
mm-hmm.
like brand new ceilings, brand new floors, brand new bathroom.
Did you murder somebody or something?
He didn't.
What year is this?
Are you past the statute of limitations? Well, I want to get on a very serious topic here when it comes to home owning. What is the best way to prep your house for zombie apocalypse?
Zombie apocalypse. Mm.
I myself am thinking of just ringing the entire house with wall-to-wall treadmills.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Wouldn't that stack up, though, if there's enough zombies?
You know, just behind each other. I mean, you know.
Yeah, but like eventually there's going to be so many of them. Right?
Why would they pick my house?
Well, I guess we need to start off
because you're the only person living and they smell you.
Why would I be the only one? Why would I?
Because you're the smart
survivor.
One putting the treadmills. So
because Bill Murray's already dead.
Yeah, right.
didn't you see Zombieland? Like,
no. I'm just trying to picture me being the sole survivor of the zombie apocalypse. That's really sad.
What is interesting, like,
is the Earth flat or round in this scenario?
Yeah, good question. Yeah. So it's funny that you said that because I was talking to a guy just the other day. He was on our podcast. He's a landscaper, and he was telling me about a guy. He was over at this guy's house, and this guy has. Have you seen like at cafes and stuff? They've got like roll down windows, you know, like you know they roll up when they're in business.
You mean like garage door?
No, yeah,
yeah, but like
the little shutter things.
Yeah, every orifice of his house, so every window, every door, everything had one of those over it. And so at night or whenever he didn't want people around, he just closed all of those things. And it
they
was
work.
Like, yeah,
but they have a lot of those in Galveston.
Well.
Like storm shutter kind of stuff?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think this was to keep the zombies out, I think.
Wow.
Well, I think the zombie ones make a hard clamp.
Yeah.
So like, you know you're in shutdown mode.
Yeah.
The other ones are like going down. Me, 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 me. I mean, what are you going to do? The zombies are coming.
Right.
Me, 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 me.
No, yeah. No, you need something faster than that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, upgraded Tim the Toolman Taylor motor on that thing.
But to go back to Dick's question about like where I think, because I think that's part of where home ownership is going. I think two of the big trends that a lot of people aren't paying attention to, one is tiny homes and two is storage container homes.
Mm. My sister's actually actively working on building a storage container home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're really, I mean, it's really cheap to get those materials. Yep. I mean, like, I think a standard size storage container is like $2,500.
Yeah. We have a friend of the show, Mark Cook with Green Zone Housing, and that's their specialty.
Yeah.
Is that. I've been in a couple of those houses, and I mean,
you're not going to convince my wife.
Oh, no. Some people. You just wouldn't go for it.
You just got to trick her. You got to bring her to one of those fancy ones. And be like,
trick her. Yeah, blindfold her till she's inside.
And it's like, oh my gosh, this is wonderful. I'm like, you're in a container. A lot of them.
But they're using them right now for those shared office spaces.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're really cheap to build.
They're building car washes out of them even.
Yeah.
There's one down on 1488.
Mm-hmm. So
that makes sense.
And they can look really nice if you, I mean, like if you know what you're doing.
Spray paint.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, little graffiti on the side.
Yeah,
invite those artists over.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think it's funny because you have so many different classes of homeowners,
right?
And then especially like the Home Depots and the Lowe's, they try to market everything. You know, like DIY, that's a big deal. And then when you start learning what you're capable of doing and what you're not capable of doing, and then you actually have the folks who just want to have like they. I think they just buy a house because they grew up being told they need to buy a house.
Right.
And they have no business of, you know, dealing with a lot of stuff. And so do you think the handyman is going to make a big comeback? Because I know it's kind of there, where you have Joe, the one like kind of Mr. Fix It All.
Plumber Joe?
Well, no, he's the plumber. He's the electrician. He has like kind of the intermediate levels of knowledge.
Well, our electrician that was just on the show this past week, he was saying that they're trying to do away with contractor licenses.
Yeah.
Right? That a lot of people aren't even having to have contractor licenses to do work anymore. And so there's going to be a lot more people at that point, in my opinion, that are going to be like, I can do everything.
Well, I mean, I think that's the biggest issue when you're, especially when you're building a home.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a control freak, I mean, how do you manage that? Because you don't know who you're hiring or who's hiring that person.
Right.
And because I remember like my dad, when they're doing their home, he had to go there at least, you know, every 5 days to correct what they purchased was wrong, and they paid extra and all this kind of stuff. Because my dad's one of those people who's hands-on with all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Well, you kind of have to be.
I mean, if you're paying money, I mean, so you're building your dream home.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, what do you do? But but then also the people who live in apartments, they're like me, I live with my wife, I can do so much. But, you know, she thinks I can do everything. I'm like, no, if it's over the 40 pounds, I don't want to deal with it. Like,
right.
I'd rather just have someone else deal with it. But do you think there's, with your show and other resources online, everyone can kind of get a gist of what's going on in their home?
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, I think that's kind of the beauty of what's happening, even with our show, because we do both. We do DIY, and then we also bring in the professionals. And sometimes we bring in the professionals so that people can do the DIY stuff. Because if they listen, you know, to, you know, a painter,
mm-hmm.
and a painter kind of walks us through, you know, like, what is the process like, you know, painting the interior of a house? Well, if someone can listen to that and go, well, I can figure that out, and they can probably find a YouTube video on how to do it. Again, like, do they enjoy it? Are they going to get pleasure out of actually doing that for their property? Maybe, maybe not. And so, yeah, those resources are, man, there's so many right now. Like, I was looking at one this morning on Pinterest. There's this guy that, I mean, he has a DIY channel on Pinterest, and he's got like 10 million followers.
Wow.
You know, because people aren't necessarily interested in doing it themselves. They're interested in thinking that they know how to do it themselves.
Well, it's always something that you have to, I always like the internet because it gives you the keyword to explain to a professional.
Yes.
So if you're dealing with a plumber, if you're dealing with an artist or, you know, a custom bench maker or something, like, this is what I saw and I liked.
Yeah.
I want something similar to this. And a lot of people put a lot of money into their homes. Do you see that the trend of people living in the same home
mm-hmm.
for the rest of their lives? Or do you see it more of some people are buying a home every 2 to 4 years and then finally they're just too old to really deal with it?
I never want to go through the home buying experience again.
The trend is
you're
right
a lifer?
Now,
you're a lifer, Sean?
Well, here's the thing. If I ever move from my house, you know, willingly, it'll be because I have the cash.
Yeah. Mm.
That's the I don't want to go through that.
So just, you're not a lifer.
I love owning my home. As a lifelong renter, 10 years ago, I bought my house. And there are many pluses and minuses to it. You know, I like the sense of ownership. I like my freedom to do stuff. But I severely miss something going down and just calling the management office.
Sure.
Or because I got like homeowner's warranty, but boy, you got to read the fine print on that.
Yes, you do.
You know, my garage door is covered, unless it's the one thing that breaks on a garage door.
Unless it's orange, because if it's orange, we will not fix it.
Yeah, it's like, to me, I think on a garage door opener, the only thing that the only consumable is the spring.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's the one thing that's not covered.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Exactly.
It's had its place.
And they'll get technical with you if it gets expensive. That's what happened on our house. I mean, like it got dicey pretty quick.
Well, what I did with mine on the furnace, I have a gas furnace, and it was stopped blowing warm. And so I called the homeowner's warranty people. They sent out their guy, and he came out and was like, okay, well, these are the things that are wrong with it. And I'm thinking, great, you know, put
fix
it down. Fix it. And then I got the word from homeowner's warranty. They're saying, well, we cover everything but A, B, and C, and B is one of the things that's wrong. So since that's one of the things that's wrong, we can't fix any of it unless you want to plunk down several hundred dollars as your copay, I guess.
Ah.
And I was like, you know what? I'm good without.
Yeah,
you know, I've got a couple of $20 Walmart space heaters, which work fine for me. And then I got a follow-up from homeowner's warranty saying since I'd started the ticket but didn't finish it, either I needed to finish it or they needed to write off the furnace.
What?
To pay me, you know, basically, so they paid what they felt was market value, like $600. It's okay, it's not covered anymore, so you can't make any claims on it.
Wow. So they wanted to pay you off.
Yeah, so it's there are pros and cons, Dick. And on the whole, I like what I have, especially as my property value keeps rising and rising because of my location. But I do miss a lot of the convenience of renting.
Yeah. The trend is right now that we're going to start seeing less and less home ownership. And
that's what I figured. Because, I mean, that's what my wife and I talked about. I go, because she wants, you know, buy a house. And I was like, well, if we buy a house, that's the house I'm
Is that going to bring back
it.
The...
Like, I'm not leaving.
The tax breaks, though? Because when I bought my house, I was in 2010. So it was coming off the 2009 tax rebate.
Right.
You buy a house, we'll give you $7,000.
Right.
Which is awesome because I owe the IRS $6,000 at the time. So
it worked out
just fine. Will we see a resurgence of that? Will they'll need to start lowering the rates again to get people to buy?
Well, the borrowing rates right now are the lowest they've pretty much ever been. I mean,
and if you live in Japan, it's even better.
Yeah, they'll give you money to borrow the money.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But the issue that we're running into is it's a mentality issue among people. This is kind of what I was talking about before with the appliances. People find value in owning the home, but what they value more is mobility. And so what we're finding with some of these younger people that are moving into that age bracket of home ownership is that they want the ability to pick up and move whenever they want. Yeah. You know, they're you know, okay, I've done Houston, cool, let's go do Atlanta now. And so having a house that you own kind of, like what Dick was saying, shackles you down to that place, you know, and you can't go unless you want to, you know, try and flip it and turn it into a rental.
Yeah, and with the trend also of being able to work remotely, I mean, most people, I would say probably more than 50% of the world these days, I mean, you can, if you've got a job that is at a desk, you can do that from anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can work from home, you can work from your RV, you can work from your car, you can work from your hotel room, you can work from wherever you need to. And so...
And Kevin and I have friends that are doing both of those things. I mean,
yeah,
one's
absolutely.
Working from an RV, one's fixing to hit the road, and I mean, like that. They're
yeah, and so, you know, I think that, you know, being tied down to a place to them is a whole lot less appealing than it used to be, for sure. Now, the thing that I think is going to be the real problem, and where, I mean, it's a pendulum, I think, because I think the pendulum is going to go one direction, and then it's going to swing back hard. And I think the reason it's going to swing back hard is because I think people are going to lack a sense of community.
Well, I think that's why Conroe and Montgomery County area is one of the fastest growing areas, and it's not fast meaning we're building a bunch of high rises,
right?
And you know, those kind of condo things. So it's more of, I think it's the community appeal where it's, you know, you can afford a house,
yep.
And people can live here for a good amount of time in that house. And you know, I don't know too many people that purchase a home just to make money.
Yeah.
From the house, there are a couple people. A lot of my friends, entry level, they did a lot of Washington stuff when Washington Street was blowing up, and they made a lot of money.
Yeah.
That was like one of my favorites was this guy bought this house that I think he bought it for like $80,000,
mm-hmm.
and it was a trash hole.
Yeah.
But I go, why are you living in this, man? He's like, I'm moving out in 4 years. Like, that's my time. I'm
yeah,
living here for 4 years. I'm talking like. The wood, I mean, it was bad. I go, no lady, my wife would not like to go there.
Right.
And then when he sold his house, I was like, congratulations. He's like, yeah, check this out. And he showed me how much money he made.
Yeah.
And I was like, he made that in 4 years? Like, that's incredible.
And they probably didn't buy it for the house. They probably bought it just to, like, demo
the No, they did. They demoed it, and he sent a picture of where his house used to be. Because it was one of those up houses where everything around it was all these new townhomes, and then they had this little...
Yeah. No.
It was owned previously by like some veteran that was disabled, and he never like they just think of a like a single man who's 80 never took care of anything.
Yeah.
So it looked like a rotting house.
Yeah, I've got
Forrest Gump.
Craig and I have a mutual friend right now that is looking for a house to slowly flip. They want to live in it for about a year, but they want to buy it at like 30% under market value, slowly flip it, and then sell it for a profit. That's what they want to do. However, there are so few of those available in this area that he's not sure he's going to be able to do it in exactly the way he wants to. In fact, there are big investment companies that's what they do. They go in and they buy severely undermarketed houses that are, you know, just trash. And they will then turn around, sell it for $5,000 profit to a flipper. who will then flip it and make a 30 grand profit on it. And so,
but that's people buying that house.
Not
the land.
Exactly. And but the thing is, like, those houses are in this market, in this area, in the Houston area, those houses are really just not available. So finding a really great deal on a house right now, you're
we'll
not
have to talk
that
off the air, because I live in a neighborhood of the Woodlands. I live in the ghetto part of the Woodlands, so called Timberlake.
There isn't a ghetto part of the Woodlands.
Yeah, there is, but no, because I got my house for incredibly cheap. Owner passed away. His second wife and the daughter hated each other. They sold it at the estate sale to someone who did just that. They sold it to a flipper for pennies on the dollar.
Yeah.
And here comes Sean and got the house for a song. I know I was in a floodplain, and my house has flooded twice since then, you know, that kind of thing. But on my street, it's a combination of homeowners. Two of us are homeowners, and the rest are they're rental properties. And I know that across the street there's a house that it's been standing there for
the
a while.
The abandoned one?
Yeah, one where, like, literally there's not a single wall inside. The thing was totally gutted. But I know that, you know, someone wants to buy it for cheap and redo it. Sooner or later, I have a feeling a developer is going to come to Timberlake's Timber Ridge and just buy us out.
Yeah.
Because you raise the house, because these houses were all built in the 70s. And you don't even have to dig for the infrastructure. Just lay it down and build over it, because we're already in a hollow.
Let's look at it like that, Sean. Do you guys know a resource that can help you protect your home? Because, like, say someone's, like, in Sean's situation, and someone comes in and's like, I want to buy all this stuff.
Right.
Like, do you guys deal with any of those kind of topics on your show, where it's like, how do I actually protect someone not coming in and buying me out or forcing me to leave because of...
Well, no one can... our neighborhood really doesn't fall under eminent domain.
Okay.
There's nothing there. But, see, the property values is just going up and up and up and up because we're 2 miles from the freeway. And the Woodlands has grown so much that we're prime real estate.
Yeah, the Woodlands is weird because it's a township. And so, like, you don't necessarily have, like, an HOA like you would have in, like, a traditional neighborhood. And so...
But they still control you.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Now, fortunately, again, my HOA, what I pay in a year is what everyone else in the Woodlands pays in a month.
Sure.
You know, it's... Again, I'm in the cheap part of the Woodlands, which is very nice.
Like, so, that happened to Ben. Uh-huh. My brother, who, like I said, Craig knows, he lived in off of Gessner and I-10. And before Harvey happened, he backed up to a ravine.
Uh-huh.
And then on the other side of the property was like a car automobile place that fixes cars. And so they had a lot of trees, so you couldn't see anything.
Right.
So when you went to his backyard, you would just see a ravine. That was it. And then when Harvey happened, the city of Houston came in, took 10 feet of his property, and then they put a sidewalk on the ravine. Yep. So they didn't really extend the ravine to make it, you know, have better water flow. But now when he goes outside, like when he has his coffee or something, people can just look into his house.
Yeah.
And then that's when he kind of he's got married and has a baby. And he's like, this is too weird, because people are just walking by his house.
Honestly, the best protection for that is a good realtor, because they will be able to explain to you easements and eminent domain and whether or not those things are potential for your property to be vulnerable to. But City of Houston is just weird, and they kind of tend to do what they want.
Yeah, that's what, when he said that he tried to fight it, it was like there's nothing they could have done. No. And like they already started, because I think the Harvard reaction was like, we got to fix these things. But he's like, why did they put in a sidewalk?
Right.
Because, like, it's visual.
Well, but like they're still backing up to a car dealer thing. So yeah,
it's cosmetic. It was just they needed something. Hey, look, you can walk along here now. The implication is that it's safer, whereas people are just going to get swept away from the sidewalk and the nearest breach.
Yeah,
I mean, that really weirded me out a little bit, because he lived there for a good while, and then all of a sudden, like, that one day your house will change, and it's not your house, it's something right around it.
Yeah, there's the comfy middle, right, where that typically doesn't happen to people. Where on the fringes, like where you live in a highly populated metropolitan area like that, or if you live in the country
and your neighbor's a meth maker.
Well,
right. Those are the best.
What happens in the country is the state decides to put in highways and thoroughfares, right? And so they'll eminent domain large chunks of property, or through the middle of your large chunk of property, to put a road. And there's not a whole lot you can do once the government decides to eminent. I mean, you can fight it, and about the only defense that you can have is like Indian burial ground, or, you know, natural preserve for a protected species, or, you know, there's a list of things that you can do. But even then, I mean, like, it's you're fighting a behemoth, you know, of an organization, and it's the same in the Woodlands. I mean, like, you know, if you go to cut a tree down in the woodlands, you're up against a corporation, a huge corporation that you're having to fight with in order to get a tree cut. But that's just the way the neighbor, that, you know, township is set up. That's part of why I say a good realtor will explain these things to you before you make that purchase, because they want you to be informed as to, you know, what kind of house you're buying. And if that's something that's going to bother you, then that person needs to be able to articulate that.
Yeah.
Well, there's pros and cons to everything, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, you just don't discover. I think that's kind of the venture of owning a home, I imagine.
It is. Yeah.
You discover these things.
Yes.
Because I bet, depending on where you live, there's some weird stuff going on. So, I mean, like, and especially that's one thing I never really fully understood is the community aspect. Like, your neighbors can be doing things, but to me, that's not my fear. My neighbors are not my fear of doing the only fear I have is that they build trash.
Yeah.
You know, because that's something I can really, like, overnight decimates, you know, your house because rats and all that kind of stuff.
Absolutely.
Like, if you have a giant wood pile next door, you're like, all right, what's going on here? Can we burn this or what are we doing? But then the HOA stuff, and then also the management company, like whoever's managing. Because I know Houston's really strange, especially the older parts of Houston. Like, my aunt had to get an arbiter to come out because Harvey destroyed one of the trees in the backyard, and she just wanted to take the tree out.
Right.
Well, you can't do anything with trees in West U unless you hire an arbiter to come out and do, you know, what's the strength of the tree. And then you have to replace a tree. So if you take a tree out there, you have to put one back. And it was funny, is secretly she was probably just trying to get a pool, but like the tree, I mean, it, you know, whatever. But I was like, you know, it's so strange just to, if you want to do something with your home, you have to go through all these hoops. But I think it depends on where you live.
Yeah.
And especially living in Houston, people know, like, it's so old there. So you have to have somewhat of an idea if you buy one of those historic houses or historic district houses and stuff like that.
Yeah. But if you live in, like, let's get to outside of Houston. Like, if you live in a rural place.
Well, like I was explaining to Holly, my wife. Sorry, like this is the best way I try to explain to her is like the beauty of Montgomery County is you can have the highest restrictions of what you can do over, say, in the Woodlands, and then you can go over to Willis.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
it's literally the Wild West. Like but you have to do everything. You have to do this. You have to do your own water. You have to do all that stuff. You probably won't even get internet for a couple years.
Yeah.
But you're living out where you can do whatever you want.
Do whatever you want. You can put a shed up if you want to. You can cut down the trees. You can put in a pool. You can do whatever you want. You can put an above ground pool.
Banjo contest.
That's right.
And your neighbor can also do whatever they want.
That's true. That's the downside, right?
Yeah.
I mean, so it's I'll tell you right now, like, I didn't really fully understand HOAs until I moved here because we didn't have HOAs where I lived. So the idea of someone telling me what I can and can't do is kind of crazy. I mean, I had a kind of spare tire out beside my house about a year ago, and I got a letter from the HOA that said, if you don't move that tire, we're going to charge you $50 a day until you get it moved. I was like, what? What? Seriously? But at the same time, I'm looking at it going, I don't see lots of spare tires around here. Like, this place is actually pretty nice. So, you know, it does protect the value of your home. Mm-hmm. The HOAs really protect the value of your home.
Well, some of them are pretty Third Reich and some are laid back. In my neighborhood, in the Woodlands proper, they're pretty, pretty grim. You know, you have an extra trash bag, you actually have to have a tag on it.
Wow.
Your lid on your trash can can't be up, so if you have an extra one, you actually have to get approval to put an extra bag out. Mine, they're like, you know, heavy trash days, you know, every other Tuesday kind of thing. But every now and then they'll raise their head, like, I've got a, you know, my driveway caved in because of flooding, and I got the, hey, you know, you need to come talk to us about this. And I did, and I pointed out I used to be on that board. I got it. And I was like, but I'm not paying $11,000 to fix my driveway.
Yeah.
You know, I'll jackhammer it and pour some gravel down eventually when I get some, you know, more money in. They're like, okay, 6 months, do you think that'll, yeah, that should do it. And that was it.
Nice.
So, you know, sometimes I'll work with you, but you got to be able to read the room on that.
And I think that's a good point too, is like just having a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
because a lot of people go in with the attitude, you can't tell me. It's like, I know my driveway looks bad. Yeah, I get it, but there's just my cheapest quote is $11,000, and I don't think I owe that much on the house itself. So I'm not gonna do it.
Right.
Well, it sounds like with the Homeowners Show, it's a good resource to hear about all aspects of the homeowning, And like, I'm always interested in the technology side because I do have a goal of owning a house one day.
Right.
But you know, it's a little different for my wife. I was like, if I'm moving once, so that's what's going on there.
I think that's wise.
And and I'm thankful for having a family that is very home centric. We're taking care of things and, you know, have a general idea, especially when you're dealing with professionals that come out. Because now, like, my sister or my mom will call me and, like, hey, can you come out here and be here when this happens?
Yeah.
Just so I have, like, something's going on. And it actually happened with Mr. Reuter. The guy wanted to charge $150 to dig a hole that's about a foot deep.
Right.
And I was like, I can dig a hole, man. I'll dig that hole.
Yeah.
And that's what really weirded me out when I was dealing with nothing against Mr. Reuter. I just thought that was really strange to
sure.
have your itemized list that specific. And he didn't even offer to dig the, like, he didn't offer, like, you could dig the hole. I was like, how can we save money here? This makes no sense. And
it's nice he even itemized it. I mean, he could have just been like, here's the package. This is what it's going
to
be.
Well, I mean, like, especially some people who just want to get to the end. They're like, hey, just fix it.
Right.
Whatever it takes.
Yeah.
And those people, you know, the thing that scares me about owning a home is if you don't know, you can't really pinpoint the problem. So when there's something going on in your house, you're like, I have no idea what's going on.
Yeah.
And it's going to take twice as long to figure out because you have no idea. But if you know it's an AC issue, you know who to call and things like that. And that's why I think the handyman should be kind of like an on-call, like on the refrigerator number.
Yeah.
Because if you're not an expert, find somebody that can come help you.
I actually think that would be a kind of a cool feature is like if you can, you know, as far as smart houses go, some of your major things that if you could attach them to the companies that you trust.
Yeah.
Right. So like when that system recognizes that, like my thermostat right now gives me like updates as to when certain maintenance things are due for my AC. If I could just automate that to contact my AC guy immediately when that happens, rather than me having to make that phone call or that email or something like that, that would be amazing.
Yeah, even if what it did was just send a message saying, hey, Craig's system is telling him that he needs to get this thing serviced.
Fluctuation.
Yeah, at that point,
that's
they could
a great
call
next
you.
Step.
Yeah, they call you and it's like, hey, your system needs some repair. Do you want us to come out and do that?
Well, do they let the user know, for instance, if your AC whacks out, can it send a text to you so you
it
get
does.
A sent? Okay, and then you can
Yeah, it does. It will send push notifications. So again, you know, you're asking, you know, the value of those things. It's how you want to interact with your home. Like if you're there and you're checking on things, you recognize, hey, this isn't functioning the way it normally does. That's one thing. But if you're out of the home a lot, like the technology side of things makes it really easy. For me, I know when someone unlocks my front door. Every single time it sends me a push notification. I know when someone locks my door every single time. I can tell who got into my door based on what code they used. So I can look at all those things.
I mean, who do you have going in and out of your house, man? You have different codes?
I have a code. He's very suspicious of me.
Yeah. But like he,
no,
Craig,
same
Craig
thing
does
with my house, same thing.
Craig does my pest control. So he's got a code to get into my house. I mean, you know, you allow those people into your home, and I can even shut it down to he can get in between 2 and 3 o'clock if I want to. So there's really nice features there. But at the same time, it depends on, do you care? Like, are you going to listen to the push notification that says you need to change your air filter in your, you know, for your AC, or are you not? Because at that point it just becomes annoying. So, I love tech stuff in my house. I absolutely love it because to me, it makes it easier to own my home. It makes it easier to work with and interact with my home.
But the government's going to take over it.
Well, they're probably going to do that anyway.
Yeah, California is already going to be maintaining your water
digitally.
It's like, boop, boop, boop. Sorry, you've used all of your water for today.
Yeah.
I'm literally in the middle of a shower.
We laugh about it, but it's probably coming.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, because water is...
It's a commodity.
Yeah, it's a commodity, and it's happening here. I mean, like there's big fights going on over water rights.
Yeah,
and
we got the ongoing battle between San Jacinto River Authority, Lone Star Groundwater Conservation District, and
no, I mean it's nothing.
So
I'm trying to figure out where the corruption is. I want to know, like, because I can see it being money because everyone's paying double for whatever. Because I see my parents' bill, and I'm like, Yeah, someone's taking something.
Okay, like, the primary issue is up until recently, Lone Star or Groundwater Conservation District board members were appointed, not elected.
Yeah.
So they said, oh, there's corruption. Now you got elected ones, but now you got PACs backing them up, so they're beholden.
But yeah, but like, where's all that money being spent?
What do you mean where it's being spent?
Well, because like, from what I understand...
For a when you're elected, that means you have a campaign. The money goes into your campaign.
No, I'm talking about
the money that you pay for your water.
Yeah, the tax money. Because you get taxed twice basically for your water.
Well, a lot of that was being turned around and put on the providers, the massive fees on Lone Star Groundwater did. And so you get like your Quad Vest of the world or whomever. They turn around and say, listen, we got to put it onto you. Mm-hmm. So it's a mess. And there are no easy answers to it. But yeah, no, it's the water situation is bigger than
well,
you
we
think.
Should be telling those people to move out of here.
To where?
Because we're eating too many people.
That's right.
You move them to Dune or something where water just
there's way
matter.
Too many people on 105 and 1488.
Okay, we'll get
there's
out there
way
with
too many
signs.
People in the woodlands.
Spinner signs.
Yankee go home. That thing just get out of here.
Way too many people.
There's a lot of people moving here from out of state.
Moving to Galveston.
Yeah. So
bringing their bugs and stuff.
Yeah. You know? I mean, I'm happy to help them, but. We inadvertently kind of stepped in it early on in the show. We had a mayor on, and at that time the city that he was serving was voting on some water rights issues.
Mm-hmm.
They were because their municipality had been managing their own water, and there was a corporation willing to come in and take over that management. And so and he was opposed to the corporation coming through. And so we had him on the show. We were talking about lots of different stuff, but that came up. And we spent a good deal of time talking about water rights in his community. And the day after that episode aired, I get an email from the CEO of this corporation saying, hey, I heard what you guys had to say on the show about this. I'd love to come on the show and clarify some stuff. And you know, like I think we were like episode 5 or something like that.
Yeah, it was early.
Yeah, and we're like, oh my gosh, what did we get ourselves into?
Did you get him on?
I invited him on. Uh-huh. The issue was, it was in November. And so by the time we would have had him on, because we typically record on Thursday evenings, and then the show goes live on Tuesdays, we would have had to have had him on that coming Thursday. By the time the show aired the following Tuesday, everyone would have already voted.
I think the vote was like on Tuesday morning.
Ah, okay, I gotcha.
And it wouldn't have mattered.
Yeah, and so I was like, just so you know, I'm happy to have you on, talk about what services you guys provide and all that kind of stuff, but like...
Interestingly enough, we never heard from
him
again.
Never heard back from him.
So...
Well, was he up for election too? Re-election? Because maybe that...
No, he was the CEO of the...
I'm sorry, the CEO, not the mayor, yeah.
Yeah. So
he's still CEO there, right?
I suppose. So. I don't know. But yeah, like water's like here in Conroe, like a lot of people don't know that like Lake Conroe is a reservoir for Lake Houston, and that Lake Houston is a reservoir for the city of Houston. And so like that was that big deal a few years back where everyone was losing their boat docks, you know, and then they started suing city of Houston for drawing on the water. And it's like, no, this was actually legal. I mean, like it's not a great deal for you, but it was actually a legal deal set up. Like I think
sounds like your realtor should have been more
you,
proactive about telling you what's going to happen.
Exactly,
you're not going to have a lake, but you're going to live on a
potential lake,
elevated area.
Well, yeah, yeah, I mean, we that was a huge problem with Harvey was
when
that,
you opened the dam. Yeah,
yeah, when the dam was open for San Jacinto. I mean, a lot of homes that had never been flooded before flooded for the first time, and they were saying it's because Lake Conroe did not do their due diligence in draining the lake early enough, and so it rose to a level that they had to open the dam, and when they did that, homes flooded that had never flooded before. So, you know, water, and the way you manage water and the way water is set up and all those sorts of things, it's a huge, huge thing. And I didn't really know until, I mean, I live out on the lake, and so I didn't know until I moved out there how big of a deal it was. I was like, oh, it's a lake. You go tubing on those things. You know, but nope, lot more than that happens. Yeah. You know?
Or you die.
Yeah.
Because Lake Conroe's like the deadliest lake in Texas, I think.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Well, because there's a bunch of yahoos that say, hold my
beer. Are there yahoos
in Texas?
Good
thing we're open Margaritaville, right?
Yeah, right.
good thing we're getting all the, you know, the nice positive people moving here.
Yeah.
Because they can get rid of us, who are the yahoos, Sean.
No, I'm sure the new people will be holding on to their beers too. They'll be IPAs.
We'll train them up right.
IPAs. They're just all hopped up at that point.
Hold my IPA. Hold my Zima.
Zima. How do you not have a want button for Kevin? That's what
So the Homeowner Show airs here on Lone Star every Wednesday at 11. So right after the show, you'll hear the most recent episode.
We'll be on right after we get off.
Yeah. It's
your turn.
And then y'all have a podcast that y'all release once a week.
Yes.
And y'all are active on social media and all that kind of stuff, letting people know, especially it sounds like it's more of an interview based where you have really interesting people come in and give you different insights to owning a home.
And if you're in Montgomery County, they're usually local people. I mean, we occasionally have the out-of-state person, but like most of the people that we bring them in studio.
But I think this episode that's coming out is kind of a little bit of a one-off. Because I think the one that's coming out is our Thanksgiving episode, isn't it?
Right.
Yeah, so Craig and I, on this one, we just kind of talk about our own Thanksgiving. So it's a little bit of a one-off. And we try to do some fun things every once in a while. We did a top 10 list not too long ago. He had a top 10 list of things he's looking, he would want to look for in a new home. And I did a top 10 list of things that I would want to look for in a new home. And they were vastly different because we like different things. And he and I are different people. So, we were kind of contrasting that to show people, listen, it's your list isn't better than anybody else's. Just know what your list is.
Yeah.
A realtor isn't going to know what to look for if you don't have a list. Like,
right.
You need to tell them what to look for, because at the end of the day, they are going to fail. You're going to get frustrated at them, and it's not because they failed. It's because you didn't give them the right information up front. So,
Would you say those like home shows that, there's basically whole television channels dedicated to the home?
Right.
Yeah, in fact, the other podcast that is in our niche
has a television show.
Like, so do you see those shows being beneficial at all? Like, This Old House is a cool show.
Is that even on the air still?
I think they celebrated, their 50th.
But it's not Bob Vila anymore.
No.
Okay.
But they have different versions of This Old House now. I know that. But do you see those shows being beneficial to people to watch? Or
I think some of them are. I mean, some of them, if they're legitimately about, like, here's how to own your home better, I think those are good. I mean, I think that some of these HGTV shows are a lot about, here, go buy these things to make your house look like this.
I always love that when they do like the makeovers and they come up and like, let's see what happens. He's like, well, first I want to tell you about what we installed. And it's like, We just painted. That's all we really did. But we put these Samsung products in. It's great. It's a whole new room.
A lot of people that we talk to that are like actual professionals that do those kinds of things can't stand that the DIY HGTV stuff, because they feel like it gives an unreasonable expectation to their customers as to the amount of time it takes.
60 minutes later, their house is finished.
Right.
I love the ones where it's like the woman saying, I'm a yoga instructor and my husband, delivers packages every other Thursday and our house budget is $1.5 million.
Exactly.
It's like, how?
Yeah. Yeah.
How do people find you on social media?
Just search for The Homeowner Show. I mean, like, it's
seriously. You're not gonna have like 500. It is The Homeowner Show.
The Homeowner Show. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. In fact, it's funny that you're surprised by that. We were surprised.
We were surprised by that.
In fact, when we were trying to figure out what we were gonna title the show, I told Craig we had like a list. We had like four or five, and I told Craig, I said, what I really want to call it is The Homeowner Show, and he was like, huh.
Let's see how many thousands we'd have to
let's see what's out there.
Yeah.
And so we go and we look up homeownershow.com. Available. It's like $3 for the website.
That's insane.
That's kind of weird.
Unbelievable. Yeah. So, again, for whatever reason, there's not tons and tons of stuff there in our niche. So, go search for The Homeowner Show. Homeownershow.com is a way to find us. You can get our Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all that from there. You can also get download our episodes from there. You can search for us on Apple Podcast and those sorts of things. Just type in The Homeowner Show.
Yeah.
And I want to show off the bling you guys brought me.
Oh, so yeah, we brought...
Yeah, there it is.
There it is.
Yeah, if people want those T-shirts, they can go buy them on Amazon. They're up there.
And they're not expensive.
No. Cool. And they're comfy.
They're super comfy.
Yeah, it feels very soft. I know, right?
Yeah.
We spared no expense.
This Old House is still airing.
Is it?
Yeah. Just to let you know.
I'm trying to... So, like, what's kind of weird is the reason we picked this kind of show is, like, we're already, like, the number two show on Apple Podcasts. And the other guy that's there has been there 10 years.
Wow.
And so, like, and we're almost caught up with him in terms of, like, reviews and different things like that. And so like we've been really surprised by the response. We really thought it was going to be like just like this fledgling hobby. But like we've gotten a good response to it. And so like we're excited about being on the radio station here because we feel like what we're doing is providing value to people who are interested.
Yeah, sure, definitely does. Yeah.
And so we want to get that to as many people as possible. I'm actually curious, Dick, because you're kind of like in that zone of like about to buy a home, all right? You know, like your wife probably has some ideas as to what she wants. What do you think would be like your top two or three things maybe that you would want that you guys would want together? Like, what would be at the top of your list?
Well, we'd probably share a bedroom.
Okay.
So that's probably number one. Probably.
So
depends on the day.
But a backup bedroom for those other nights. A more liberal style
house. I got it. Okay.
Yeah, we're very progressive in our house.
But you need a backup bedroom for the times you take her off. Yeah.
I mean, honestly, I don't. The thing that we probably disagree on, that's kind of going not answering your question, is how long do we want to own a house for?
Right.
Because I've always, like I said, I want to own. If I bought a house, that's a house I'm going to die in, kind of thing. So I really don't know because. You know, she's pretty much the one that's going to tell me what to do.
Uh-huh.
So probably the question should be asked to her.
To her?
Yeah.
Just get her on.
I mean, I kind of already designed my own. I have my own office. I have my own workbench.
Uh-huh.
So my garage could be my office. Like, I make it both. So when I do any electrical stuff or computer stuff, I have in my office right now, but I could easily do it in a garage. So I'm very mobile with my stuff.
Okay.
So, and she even knows that. She knows I could just live in a room. Like, I have everything in the room, and besides the bathroom, because that'd be kind of gross. But, like, she knows I could have my computer and all that stuff right here. I can have a single bed, and I'm good. Like, that's all I really need. She'd be the more of the decorating, being very – the house has to be presentable. I mean, the only thing I would really want in the house that would cost for stupid money is have a cold water filter spout in every room. Because I love drinking water, so I'm in bed. I don't want to get out of bed. I'd be like, here we go, just that. And then I have some water. Okay. Because that would probably be like, that'd be over the top. But
That's one of those super niche things, like where some people are like, I want to have a urinal in my, you know, my master bathroom. Yeah. It's like, and the wives are going, no. but the guys are like, why? I mean, well, it's my bathroom.
You just tell the guy that's what the shower's for, right?
I think those go to different places.
Yeah, that was a joke. but no, and that's one thing I think that the advantage of dreaming, it's something you could dream about and you make it work. And to me, I'm always comfortable wherever I am. Like, I'm like, okay, cool. I can live here.
I tell people that because I could have cared less what our house looked like. I just wanted the property.
Yeah.
I just wanted the land. I wanted to walk around some trees. Yeah. I mean, there could have been like just a patch of ground where a house could have been built.
I think that's probably what I would put. I put restrictions on that. Like, I want to be able to shoot a gun and not get in trouble.
Uh-huh.
I want to be able to burn stuff and not get in trouble. So those are pretty much...
It's pretty destructive, Dick.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's something to, you
I
know...
I want to launch an ICBM at the neighbors and not get in trouble.
Well, I mean, I like burning
stuff. I want a flamethrower the dog
He's
next
Korea.
Door.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's just kind of like when you're... that's the community thing. You invite people over. It's like, you guys want to shoot a bunch of guns?
Yeah,
like, yeah, because that was one thing I discovered.
I'm more of a barbecue.
You can either do it with me,
guy,
or I can do it at you.
Well,
it involves fire, right?
Like, I discovered that visiting Holly's family. They live in Atlanta, and they own, what's really cool about their family is they own, I think, like over 300 acres, but everyone in the family lives somewhere on it.
Yeah.
So when it's dinner time, everyone gets together. Like, some people ride horses over, some people ride buggies, some people drive. But then it's kind of like, so what do you guys want to do? And like, let's go shoot some guns. So they have a shooting range.
Is this one of those compounds I read about, like the
branch? No, that's why I was like, this is really weird. And but no, like I was
don't
like,
don't drink the Kool-Aid that they pass out over there.
No, it wasn't anything like that. Okay. And I was very surprised, and I liked that. I was at, and that's where my brother out in Liberty. My parents have a little trailer with on their property. So we meet halfway and we hang out.
But you definitely can't live in the Woodlands. You can't live in Houston. Mm. You got to live in Cut and Shoot.
That's actually, that's where I told Holly, I was like, I want to live in Willis or Cut and Shoot or more East County just so I can do whatever I want. But she didn't like that because she didn't like the idea of the utilities and stuff. So she was like, no, we're not doing that. She wants to live in a suburban home. And I'm like, screw that.
Just buy that and have a little bat cave.
I think is interesting about like the tiny home movement is like most of those houses are on wheels, right?
Yeah.
And so like you could have your house in the neighborhood like what you wanted and then on the weekend hitch it up and go to the place in the country.
Yeah.
And I actually think that's something that's going to become more and more commonplace is like, you know, hitching up your house and just taking it different places.
Well, Holly's tiny, so it might work for for her.
There you go.
You'd be bonking your head on the doorway, though.
Well, I mean, especially when you're playing ahead, planning on having a family, and that's really what, like, the disadvantage of me trying to say, oh, we're only buying one house, because, I mean, what happens if we're like my cousin and have eight kids?
Yeah.
You're like, oh, we only have a four-bedroom house or a two-bedroom house, like, a lot of bunk beds.
That's exactly what happened. Yeah,
the Brady house only had one bathroom.
So, that's true. But no, I think that's
a huge house too.
I know, right?
I think that's kind of you decide. That's how you transition. And that's kind of me going, this is impractical to live here.
Yeah,
we need to figure this out. Because I know a lot of people go through that through their ages. So when all the kids are gone, you're like, you know, we don't really need to take care of this house. Because I know, like, the house my parents built, they built it to die in because basically they built the extra wide doors so they can get the dead body out. Like, that's
forward thinking.
Yeah, no, really. Like, but really, it's like if you're in a wheelchair or something, you can scoot in and scoot out. But it, like, and I was thinking, I was like, all right, so you're at that point, but, you know, when you're buying a home or taking care of it, you don't really, sometimes most people don't think that far ahead.
Well, it's tough to think about that when you're 30, because you think that, you know, you're eternal.
Well, I mean, it's more of an affordability, but I think we're in a good position living in Montgomery County because you have a lot of options.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what I was trying to, like, because Holly worries about this stuff all the time. And I was like, well, you know, certain people have that expectation. It's like, oh, I want to live in the Woodlands by Market Street. I'm like, I don't ever want to be that kind of person.
Yeah, right.
But, you know, but the availability of East County to me is something that's where I'd like to end up, but only if they expand 105 a little bit, because that's a nightmare.
Oh, getting out to cut and shoot's awful.
Yeah, but that's something that we kind of talk about, because I don't plan on moving out of this area.
Yeah.
I don't plan on it.
You know, I think we need to have a tiny home person that builds tiny homes out, because
a tiny person to build tiny?
Yeah, that'd even be. Yeah, that
seems like the best
the
person to do it.
Of hyphens, a tiny dash home person.
Yeah, because I think we need to. I have a really interesting question I think
a
lot
of business.
Oh, yeah, there's tons of them around here, actually. But, you know, why would you buy a tiny home over, like, a fifth wheel, for example?
Mm-hmm.
Because, I mean, some of these tiny homes, I mean, they're nice on the inside. They've got certain, you know,
amenities
in them. But, like, you go buy a nice travel trailer, and they've got, like, slide outs, and so they get their
my son just bought one in their RV. With,
they're huge.
Yeah,
and so it's like, really, what at the end of the day, what's the difference? And so maybe it's just a trend. I don't know.
It's a house versus a trailer.
Yeah.
Well, I know. I know the trailers and everything like that. The downside is the quality. So
yeah,
it's kind of like, imagine driving your house everywhere.
Yeah.
The bumps and everything, like, something's going to come loose. But then again, that's part of living in that kind of lifestyle.
Yep.
So
you're choosing that.
Well, I mean, imagine having a piece of property and you when you have kids, you just expand little tiny houses.
Yeah.
So
buy another storage unit.
I'm in favor of
one more container.
I want to put my kids in a separate building.
I
need that.
I had those fantasy moments myself.
Yeah. So
make sure they get into the camping atmosphere. So it's like, oh, just go out into the tent, live out there for a week. See what happens.
It's not safe
it's
for the animals.
Son.
And then they get sick. And you're like, why are they sick? Oh, they have ticks. Oh, great. Call Excalibur. So,
hey, I like how you brought that around.
Yeah.
That
well,
I want to transition.
I want to say thanks for coming in, guys. And if you're listening right now to Dick and Skippy, we're about signing off. But coming up right next is the Homeowners Show.
Woo-hoo.
And so you guys release a podcast on Tuesdays. It airs on Lone Star Community Radio on Wednesdays at 11. You have social media. Do you guys do Q&As at all? Like, if I'm a homeowner and I want to call in or ask y'all. Cause
yeah, you can email us at info@homeownershow.com.
Okay.
You can message us on Facebook. We love taking questions. Actually, we have an interview coming up this Thursday with a home cleaning service. So if anybody has any good questions about home cleaning, we're going to have an expert in about that.
Okay.
So we'll have Chelsea on to inform us.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's someone you don't want to do it, right?
Yeah.
It's one of those things.
That's why I hired her.
Yeah, that's right. Well, guys, thank you so much for coming in. You're listening to Dick and Skippy in the Mornings. We are going to be back here on Friday. We don't have a guest currently scheduled, so if you're interested, I think we actually do. I think we just got one. I think Wayne Keller I just realized last night, for Cadence Hope, they're doing the 14th, they're doing a fundraiser at Pacific Yard House. We'll post more information about that soon on our social media. You're listening to Dick and Skippy at IRLoneStar.com, Conroe's FM 104.5, 106.1, and of course, Facebook.com/Dick and Skippy Live on video.
We will see you guys on Friday.